Good evening and welcome to tonight's meeting of the Commonwealth Club of California, the place where you are in the know, and find us on the internet at commonwealthclub.org. I'm Mary Cranston, past chair of the Commonwealth Club Board of Governors, senior partner of the law firm Pillsbury, Winthrop, Shaw, Pittman, and your moderator for this program. And now it's my pleasure, great pleasure, to introduce today's special guest, Cherie Blair, prominent attorney specializing in discrimination and human rights, founder of the Cherie Blair Foundation for Women, and author of the memoir, Speaking for Myself, My Life from Liverpool to Downing Street. While many of you probably first heard of Cherie Blair as the wife of the renowned British Prime Minister, Tony Blair, in professional circles in the UK, US, and around the globe, she's known as Cherie Booth, QC. She was a brilliant student at the London School of Economics and has had an extraordinary legal career in the field of human rights. For 10 years, she juggled the highly public role as Britain's First Lady with her demanding legal career, her tireless work for the rights of women and children around the globe, and her job as mother to four children, one of whom was born while she was at Downing Street. Her book, Speaking for Myself, is a fascinating glimpse into what made Cherie Blair a woman capable of that kind of contribution and the stresses and strains that she faced in pulling it off. Since stepping out of the political limelight, she has continued her extensive involvement in human rights, setting up the Cherie Blair Foundation for Women in 2008, which works with women in Africa, South Asia, and the Middle East, helping women generate their own income and become sustaining entrepreneurs. Mrs. Blair is closely involved with over 20 charities involving women and children and with her hometown of Liverpool. So please join me in welcoming Cherie Blair to the Commonwealth Club tonight. So Cherie, you had a very interesting upbringing, probably not what people would normally expect for someone who has the kind of high profile career you have today. Could you talk about your childhood, the family members that helped you and shaped you?
I think interesting is the right word, Mary, and in the Chinese sense, I think, because I come from a slightly unusual family in that both my parents were actors, which in one way was a good thing, and my father in my childhood actually was quite a famous actor, particularly in his hometown of Liverpool. Partly because he played the son-in-law in a program that was one of the early great soap hits in the UK called Till Death Do Us Part, which became over here in America something called All in the Family.
Oh, yeah, right.
And in that, my father played the son-in-law. He essentially played himself. feckless, left-wing agitator. And that in itself was quite interesting. But I was also born into a Catholic family. And because my parents were actors and very young, my mum was only 21 when I was born, my dad was 22, I was left as a child with my grandmother in Liverpool while my mother and father continued with their acting career. And then when I was three, my mother decided to bring my sister and I together, and she came back to Liverpool to live. And then when the age of eight, in a Catholic community where divorce really was not heard of, my father shocked our local community by putting in the local paper a birth announcement of the birth of his third daughter, the third daughter not being a daughter by my mother. And from that time onwards, my mother was a single parent bringing up her two daughters alone. And I think that shaped me in many ways. First of all, it taught me that women, you don't know what's going to happen. You have to stand on your own two feet and have your financial independence. I think that was particularly the case for my mother, who had been a RADA-trained actress, and after my father left her, found herself working in a fish and chip shop, which is a very British thing, in the dock area of Liverpool. And really, from what her hopes and ambitions had been to what she found herself at that moment, She, of course, rose from that, got herself a new career in the travel industry, and brought up my sister and I to be very fiercely independent women with the help of my grandmother. But when I was eight, it really affected me. And because I went to school and it was a huge scandal. My grandmother was the cousin of the parish priest. I mean, these things just didn't happen in those days. And I got quite a lot of teasing in the playground. And as a result, I'm afraid I was a bit of a fighter back. So, and what happened was one of the teachers said to my mum, "I think that Cherie needs a new challenge." And so I skipped a grade, you would say. So I went from being, because I was a September baby, one of the oldest in the class, to being the youngest in the class above. And that was when I suddenly realized that, you know, actually I was a clever girl as well. And really, it channeled me into using education to make my way in the world. So another big theme in my life has been the importance of education. And my great belief that I owed it to my mother and my grandmother for all their struggles to not be like my dad and disappoint them.
You know, one of the things you mentioned in the book is that your grandmother had a very significant sense of class in Britain and that she was in the working class. How did that affect you?
I think it's certainly one of the things that made me join as soon as I could at 16, the Labour Party. It made me a strong believer in equal opportunities for people, that people shouldn't be held back. Both my mother and my grandmother left school at 14. My grandmother, because that's what happened if from her class at 14, they left school. My mother actually had hoped to go on beyond 14, but at 14, her own mother had died. Her father was a miner. She had a 10-year-old brother. And basically, she had to leave school to look after him and her brother. And that again, was, I often think, what my mother and grandmother might have been had they had the opportunities that I had. And sometimes when people will say to me later on, it must have been quite difficult with three children and then later four children in Downing Street and, you know, having a demanding career. I think I always say, compared to my mother, who had no money, she had fortunately the support of her mother-in-law, but really had to struggle to bring up my sister and I. You know, I had it easy because of my education, I had the ability at least to pay for help, and indeed I did. You know, it makes a big difference. And I'm always very conscious that I'm a privileged woman compared to many women still today who don't have that ability to be able to buy good quality help.
Well, you know, when you were young, obviously your family was very constrained in terms of their resources. How did you get yourself into a first-class university and get into the career that you've been in? How did that happen from your background?
I think the other thing that happened to me, when I said my mother and father left me with my grandmother. My grandmother at that time was only 51, and I became like a late baby to her. And sometimes looking back on it now, I think in the end I was probably the boy in that household. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, they were all very keen. So, you know, I was able to do my homework. I was in some ways indulged, and a lot of that is to do with that belief that my grandmother had in me, and all that I might achieve, and all their hopes. You know, I was very conscious of carrying that. And it made me a very confident young woman. And then I went to a convent school, and for, you know, the nuns were always telling us that, you know, all we had to do was work hard at school and we would achieve our dreams. Now, it's fair to say that their definition of our dreams was in fact, I can always remember on the first day at my grammar school, the head teacher coming and announcing that the then head girl, Mary Jo McElroy, had achieved the pinnacle because she had agreed she was going to enter the order, and saying, calling upon us all to pray that we too would have vocations, and praying, please God, you know, I know vocations are very good, but please not me.
So I had that same prayer.
But you know, then on the other hand, that they didn't tell me that there was any reason why, if I didn't work hard, I couldn't get all the things. And of course, I worked hard, and I got good exam results, and I went to the LSE. And when I went to the LSE, the London School of Economics, they didn't tell me that there was any obstacle if I didn't work hard that I wouldn't be able to achieve my dreams. And it was only when I left the London School of Economics and actually started working as a lawyer in the real world that it suddenly was told to me, oh, well, actually, you know, there is an obstacle mm-hmm. to you achieving your dreams, and that was, you're a girl.
Why don't you talk about those early years and, you know, what it felt like to realize that and what you did to kind of compensate and to get on with it, even though there was gender stereotyping?
Well, I think actually that what we did, and I'm sure there's many women in the room who know that as well, I mean, you just kind of did get on with it. That was just the way it was. You mentioned that I came top of my year at the LSE, and then I became top of the bar finals in England and Wales. And yet when I tried to find a firm to take me on, they would say things like, well, we don't take girls. Or they would say, well, we do take girls, but we've got one, and so we couldn't possibly...
Take another,
mm-hmm. because... You know, you might both become pregnant together, and obviously the whole world would then collapse. And even when I did find somebody who was prepared to take me, at the end of my year's training, basically he said to me, well, Cherie, there's two candidates for the one position. One's a boy and one's a girl. So obviously we'll take the boy. And... you know, even he thought that was unfair because he knew I was the better lawyer. And of course, he was right. And he was Tony Blair.
Yeah.
So. And the irony is, of course, 7 years later, Tony Blair stopped being a lawyer and did something else. I can't quite remember what it is now. Whereas I stayed on, and here I am 35 years on, and I'm still a lawyer. Yeah, exactly. So actually, if you were betting on who was going to stay as a lawyer, they probably made the wrong choice. But I didn't say... but excuse me, this is outrageous, and I'm better qualified than he is, and you know, I'll take you to court for discrimination, partly because in those days, though we had a sex discriminator, it had just started, and in fact, I made my career doing those cases. At that time, it didn't apply to self-employed people, and as barristers, we were self-employed, so I wouldn't have had a case anyway, but that was just the way it was. So I thought, oh, well, okay, well, then I'll try here. And you just... I don't know why. I mean, you know, when I look at the statistics now and think that at the time only 10% of the profession were women, what on earth was I thinking of that someone like me, who didn't have family members in the law, didn't have any money behind her, had no, you know, was the first person in my family to go to university, how could I possibly have imagined that I could become a lawyer? And yet I did.
It's probably in part because nobody told you couldn't.
No, absolutely. And indeed, my grandma and everyone else had sort of told me that so long as I worked hard, it would be all right. And actually, maybe they were right.
So you were in this, you had gotten out of LSE and you were in training to be a barrister, and you met this young man. So
yeah.
What was that like?
Yeah, well, that was his secret weapon, wasn't it, really? If he hadn't been so charming and I hadn't... taken a fancy to him, maybe I would have stood up and said, I'm going to fight you for this place. instead of which, I found another place.
You know, there's an interesting question I got about how Tony proposed to you, which is
yes.
a good story. So
it is a good story. You know, despite all that feisty talk from my mum and grandmother about what I could achieve, like every girl, you know, one imagined that when Prince Charming finally came and swept you off your feet, the least he would do would be kneel down before you and ask for your hand in marriage. Now, in my case, however, it was me who was kneeling down, not asking for his hand in marriage, But it was, we'd been on holiday in Italy, very romantic, in Siena, and we'd stayed in this rented accommodation. And in the very last day, obviously we had to tidy up after us, so obviously I was doing the tidying up, you know. Tony's not one of those men who finds his inner housewife very easily. Still, I'm afraid. And so I was actually in the bathroom on my hands and knees cleaning the floor and the toilet when he came up behind me and said, Cherie, I think we should get married. So there was a moment when I thought, well, shall I argue about the appropriateness of this venue or shall I just say... quickly say yes before he changed his mind. So I went for the latter option.
And a good choice it was.
What is it, 31 years later, we're still, 32 years later, actually.
Well, congratulations.
We got married the following year. Yeah.
So let's talk a little bit more about your career, because it has been fairly extraordinary. So you are a QC. Could you just explain briefly the legal barrister system so American audiences can understand
it? It's slightly complicated to explain, but in Britain we essentially divide our legal profession into two, into the solicitors, who you'd call, I suppose, the attorneys, who in general, and it's not entirely true now because it's much more fluid, would see the clients, give general advice. And then the barristers at the bar, who would be the trial attorneys, the advocates, who would be the specialists in particular legal areas. And within the barrister, the difference is there are over 100,000 solicitors in the UK, and there are 12,000 barristers today. And within the barristers' profession, after about 10, 15 years, you can apply to be recognised as one of the leaders of the profession by becoming something called the Queen's Counsel. And literally the full title is one of Her Majesty's Counsel Learned in the Law. And it goes back to Charles II, who, when he came back to England after the restoration of the monarchy, appointed several lawyers to be his personal advisers. And from that, this whole tradition of Queen's Counsel. And essentially, you're supposed to be the expert trial lawyers. Now, I had a very interesting experience because about 70 of those a year are appointed. And even today, still only 11% of Queen's Counsel are women. It's still the first Queen's Counsel who was appointed was in 1949, and she was someone called Rose Howbrom. And she was a woman from Liverpool, too. Mm-hmm. And... years later, as a young girl, my grandmother was a great admirer of Rose Howbron, and she actually had there was a TV series based on Rose Howbron. And I don't, somehow in the back of my mind, I suppose I thought if one, in her case, Jewish girl from Liverpool could make it, then so could I. But when I actually was appointed Queen's Counsel, which was in 1995, traditionally, that had always been announced on a Thursday, the Thursday just before the Easter, Maundy Thursday, we call it in the Catholic religion. And my husband had become leader of the opposition, and that day, the Queen had invited him for the first time to go to Windsor Castle for dinner. So actually, when we went to Windsor Castle that night, I was one of the few Queen's Counsel who were actually able to personally thank the Queen for appointing me one of her legal advisors. And she was very gracious, and traditionally when the Queen gives these dinners, the Royal Library puts on a display, and part of the display they put on that night from her collection were some letters patent and other historic documents about Queen's Counsel.
Oh, that's really great. So another thing that you did that was fairly unusual is when you founded your own chambers, the Matrix Chambers, where you are still practicing today, and it was in part because you wanted to focus on an area of law that wasn't as traditional. Could you talk a little bit about that?
I think that was much later on. The interesting thing about the bar is it can be a very conservative profession. In some ways, we're very... innovative. We are very innovative because as a trial advocate, you have to be, and we're always developing the law. But sometimes in our own practices, we are much more conservative. And I started to think that there were better ways of organizing the profession on the way we did our law. I'd become very interested in technology and had become chair of the bar's IT committee. And then my husband's government had introduced this new Human Rights Act, and I thought it was a great opportunity to try and break down some of the traditional ways of doing the law. And so we founded Matrix Chambers. Actually, in the end, I realized that some traditions have some advantages, because one of the traditions is that you rank your barristers by length of seniority. And also the more senior barristers get the better rooms. But because we were all very kind of, you know, new and modern, we decided that instead of that we do it all alphabetically, which was fine, didn't mind that. But then somebody came up with this great idea that we'd allocate the rooms by lot. So I thought, oh, well, I took a deep breath and said, all right, we'll do that as well. And then to my horror, of course, when we did the lot allocation, I came bottom, you know. So that required a little bit of finessing on my part to make sure that I didn't actually get the little box room round by the photocopier. But sometimes, you know, you can have principles, but maybe you have to slightly adjust.
Just.
You are listening to the Commonwealth Club of California radio program, and our guest is Cherie Blair, noted attorney, founder of the Cherie Blair Foundation for Women, and wife of former British Prime Minister Tony Blair. So let's talk.
I'm glad you said that, because once I was somewhere and I was introduced as the former wife of the British Prime Minister.
That would be news. That
they
would
got
be
the
news.
Former in the wrong place. So I always listen very carefully.
I'll try
now.
To be good. So let's talk a little bit about being the spouse of the Prime Minister. Obviously, that was a very dramatic shift in your life and your children's life. What stands out for you about those years and the changes that you had to go through?
Well, I suppose, first of all, it was just an incredible privilege to have that opportunity to live in this extraordinary place, which, you know, is world famous, to get the chance to have a ringside seat on, well, some of the things that have shaped our world that we see today, whether it's, you know, September the 11th, whether it's the going in Bosnia, whether it's things in my own field that my husband's government introduced, like the Human Rights Act, like a lot of employment rights for women that they changed, to have that privilege, and then also to have these extraordinary experiences that how could this girl from working class Liverpool actually get to meet the Queen? And indeed, every year with my husband, we would go to Balmoral while the Queen was there during her summer holidays and spend a weekend with the Queen and see her with her family. And there's a tradition of going on a barbecue, which is kind of astonishing. Mm-hmm. Or to come and be friends with not just one, but two American presidents, and have Stevie Wonder in the Clinton White House sing Ma Cherie Amour for me. That was definitely a pinch me moment. Mm-hmm. Or as a good Catholic girl to meet both Pope John Paul, well, a sort of good Catholic girl, I don't claim to be absolutely perfect, but have both Pope John Paul and Pope Benedict meet both of those. I can remember the first time we went on the official visit by the Prime Minister to the Vatican, and you parade through the Vatican, and traditionally, so I was in, you know, black with the black mantilla, and going down, and the Swiss Guard lined the hallway and the artwork, and I'm thinking, my grandma's up there in heaven saying to them all, that's my Cherie down there. I mean, how can all of that have happened? It's quite incredible, really. So it's an incredible privilege. And we met many incredible people, not just the people that everyone knows, but some of the people you meet around the world who are doing fantastic work, whether it's the women working with the acid brides in Bangladesh and meeting those women who, because their husband's family felt their dowry wasn't good enough, you know, have battery acid thrown in their faces, you know, which is horrible, horrible thing, or the women in Rwanda who lost husbands and children in the genocide and yet somehow managed to rebuild their society there. I mean, how can you not feel that you have had a fortunate life? Now, not all of it, of course, was so fortunate. I certainly did have my ups and downs with the British press from the moment that they tricked the police officer into knocking on the door and insisting I come down and got the picture of me in my nightie, which was as I opened that door and realised that all the press were outside, all I could think of was Tony is going to kill me for being so stupid. That sort of thing.
We've gotten a number of questions about the impact that you had as Tony's partner on government and policy, and then also, what opportunities you saw to advance programs that were dear to your heart. Could you talk about that kind of?
I think the biggest lesson you have to learn when you're married to a politician is that the people elect him or her and not you. And you have to particularly remember that when your partner becomes the leader of the government. Because despite the fact that they do elect him and not you, you do find yourself thrust upon a stage. So you may not have power, but you do have a platform. And the question is, how do you use that platform? At the same time, not usurping the proper role of the person who's elected, not just your spouse, but actually also all the other people in Parliament who have been elected. And it's quite a delicate balancing act. So I don't think you ask what impact did I have on the policy of government. The answer is zero. But did I have influence and the ability to particularly assist some of the programs that the government was doing that I particularly cared about, whether it was about rights for women at work or the whole domestic violence agenda that we changed whilst Tony was in Parliament, then yes, you can do things. And for myself, because of my passion of about women and my belief that strong women, make strong societies, a lot of the work I did was around women and children. And I had the great privilege in Downing Street when we went in, because we went in, Tony was the youngest Prime Minister of the 20th century. We had three children aged 9, 11, and 13, so they were very young. And we wanted to make Downing Street more accessible. We wanted to have more people in. We particularly wanted to have more children in so that my kids didn't feel that they were completely cut off. And once a week, I would host a reception for. We invited charities to write in. I didn't choose which charities that Downing Street would choose, and I would host a reception for amazing people up and down the country who were doing great work, either in our country or abroad, whether it were in all sorts of areas. And to have all that knowledge and to learn and to meet all those people, it was an incredible.
What was your favorite accomplishment as a First Lady?
Now that's an interesting one. I think, I'm a mother, so I'd have to say my favorite accomplishment as First Lady was to be the first woman in 150 years to give birth to the, and that was a surprise.
Your son, Leo.
My son, Leo, who's now 11, and lots of people say, is he really 11? But he was born in 2000, so he is indeed 11. And then I think that you're very conscious when you're in Downing Street that you're only there for a time, and that there were people before you whose achievements you've built on, and there are going to be people after you that you hope you will pass on a good legacy to. And when I came into Downing Street, Norm Major before me had fought very hard to get, and she managed to get at least some part-time help. Before that, no Prime Minister's spouse had any administrative help whatsoever from Downing Street. And when I left, I had ended up, after a bit of a struggle, with two assistants, and to be able to pass on and actually an acknowledgement that there was a role for the spouse. And so by the end of their 10 years, when Sarah Brown and then Samantha Cameron have come in, it was just accepted that there would be an infrastructure for them. So I'm proud that at least through the struggles and ups and downs that I had to that, they didn't have to, they'll have their own struggles, mm-hmm. that's for sure, but they didn't at least have to take on those battles.
How did having Tony as the Prime Minister and living in the fishbowl, as you talked about it in some of your other writings, how did that affect your marriage and the children?
Well, as far as the strange thing about the marriage is it did affect our marriage. Of course it would, because I've been very, very lucky in my husband. You know, he's always been really supportive of me, apart from the time he stole my, you know, job. But,
he wasn't your husband then.
He wasn't my husband then. And even so, I think he felt rather guilty about it. But he's always been extraordinarily supportive. And throughout the time, we've had a relatively equal marriage, because you do. And, you know, in a good partnership, there's compromises and give and take. But then suddenly your husband becomes leader of the country. And those compromises and give and take become a bit more difficult because, you know, he really has a good excuse. Yeah. So there would be times, Tony always liked to be involved with our kids, and he always liked to try and put them when they were younger to bed. And indeed, when he was a backbench MP in the 1980s, one of the people in the Whip's office who sort of tell the MPs what to do, insofar as anyone can tell them what to do, took him to one side one day and said, Tony, if you stop leaving Parliament after the vote at 7 and only coming back just before the vote at 10 o'clock, you need to spend more time in Parliament, in the bars, chatting up your colleagues, and if you don't do that, you will never get anywhere in politics. Sat happily for us, Tony didn't do that, and he was wrong, because he did get to the top in politics. But nevertheless, then he becomes Prime Minister, and then Leo comes along, and people don't realise that, unlike at the White House, you know, it is the spouse who is supposed to do the cooking in 10 Downing Street. And so the office would always tell me when, you know, and the diary would come up about when he was coming home, and the kids always used to joke that Tony would say, you know, where's Cherie and where's my dinner? And so, but there were times, of course, that they'd say he'd come up at 7 o'clock, and, you know, they'd say he wants to put the baby to bed. So, you know, you'd keep Leo up, you'd make the dinner, and then by 8 o'clock he still hadn't come. So baby tired, baby in bed, dinner ruined. And then he'd come in and you'd go, you know, where have you been? And he'd say, I'm really sorry, but I had to talk to the president over the secure phone. And at that point, you really can't put the dinner in the bin, because actually it is a good excuse. Yeah. It is a good excuse. And so you have to, and that does shift the balance. And actually one of the things about coming out of 10 Downing Street is I now feel I have to remind him from time to time that now he isn't Prime Minister. That excuse doesn't work quite as well. You know, and he had to relearn those good behaviours that we do. I can't say he's completely successful in that either, but yeah, we keep trying. So it did change that dynamic. For the kids, I think it was different from our youngest son, of course, was born in 10 Downing Street. And so when we left at the age of 7, he had never known another home. And he didn't realise that most people, I can remember, you know, the state opening of Parliament, and we used to take Leo to watch, he'd watch through the window and see the Queen, and he'd see the Queen and she'd be waving to the crown, and Leo would say, oh, she's waving at me. And that was because he came with us to Balmoral, he'd actually met the Queen. So he didn't realise that most little 7-year-old boys didn't meet the Queen. That wasn't what happened. You know, so that for him, it was, I don't know how much of that he will really remember. Mm-hmm. Because 7, he'll remember something, but 7 is still very young. Whereas for my older children, of course, Catherine, my daughter, was the longest. She went from 9 to 19 living in 10 Downing Street. and her brothers at 11 and 13, they went to university, obviously. So they, and once they go to university, though they come home, it's not quite the same. So they had a different experience because they went through their teenage years at number 10. And that's an interesting challenge. I think particularly for my eldest son, because he was the eldest, and there was that incident. I don't know whether you knew about it in America, but we have exams at 16, national exams called the GCSEs. And traditionally, after doing those exams, the young people tend to go and celebrate. And my son went to celebrate with some friends and ended up drunk in Leicester Square, which is not totally unusual. But the difference was the next day he was front page news on all the newspapers. And what made it worse from my point of view, and actually from Tony's point of view, is that actually it was on Tony's watch, because it was literally, Leo had been born in the May and the exams were like in the June, and I'd gone away for a week. I'd taken Leo and my mum and we'd gone to stay at a friend's house in Portugal just to have a little bit of a rest. And of course, whilst I was away, the day before I was coming home, this is what happened. So as you can imagine, I was not pleased with Tony. I said, well, you know, I go away for a minute and what happens, you know, sun plastered over the front page. But obviously that makes a difference for them, because poor Ewan was mortified, not so much about the impact on him, but that he felt he'd let his father, the father down.
You know, if we asked your children, whether the pluses outweighed the minuses of being in the limelight like that for their childhood, what would they say?
I think all of them would say that they definitely did outweigh. That all of them they're very interested in international affairs, in politics. They're all engaged. They're all members of the Labour Party. I know that they realised it was a privilege, and to have that experience. You know, they met Nelson Mandela, they met Hillary Clinton, they met the Pope, they met the Queen. I mean, how can you not think that that isn't mm-hmm. a privilege?
You know, one of the interesting things in your book was about the family finances, because yeah. I assumed that when your husband was the Prime Minister, you know, things would get taken care of. But actually, in fact, the fact that you had your career was actually you were actually the breadwinner, and that was quite important to keeping this whole operation going.
Oh, very much so. And of course, having been through, as a child, I suppose, being very, very well aware of what it's like to have very little money. I don't want to suggest we were the poorest of the poor, because we weren't, but we lived in a working class area. We were no worse off than our neighbours, but none of our neighbours were very well off. And so I've always been fairly conscious of how lucky I am to have been able to earn a good living for myself. But when we went into number 10 Downing Street, of course, I wasn't entirely sure how much of my practice of law I'd be able to continue. Luckily, I was able to do that, but you know, financial concerns, and it was always kind of my responsibility to manage the family budget.
So you're listening.
Quite often, that's quite traditional too, in many ways. I remember my grandfather, who was a merchant seaman, and he would always hand his wage packet over to my grandmother, and she would give him back his pocket money. And
that's interesting.
You know, yeah.
So you're listening to the Commonwealth Club of California radio program, and our guest is Cherie Blair, noted attorney, founder of the Cherie Blair Foundation for Women, and wife of former Prime Minister Tony Blair. Let's talk a little bit about the press, because you were in the limelight for a long time. There were times when the press was rather hard on you. How did that affect your family, and what advice would you have for young women in power positions or who are likely to be covered by the press?
I think that Tony always says that the British press, to complain about the British press is like complaining about the British weather. It's a fact of life, and you have to get used to it. I think when Tony first became leader of the opposition, I had not really appreciated, I knew it would make a difference for him, but I didn't realize it would make a difference for me. And maybe I was naive in that. And maybe also it was simply because we were a younger couple, because I actually was, like most women, you know, most women in Britain now, even with families, work. You know, women are nearly 50% of our workforce. But it hadn't ever, it was almost a generational thing that hadn't really ever been reflected in the Prime Minister's family before. And so there was obviously interest in that. And I suppose that took me somewhat by surprise. The other thing it took me by surprise was this constant obsession with my appearance, because, well, we're lawyers. Now, we have to look smart and businesslike, but I don't think the main feature of any lawyer, including a female lawyer, is to be a fashion plate. You know, yes, obviously, we all like to look nice, but it wasn't the main focus. Suddenly, it became the main focus of what I was represented in the press, and that was a bit of a shock, because I'd been used to people concentrating on what I said and what I did in court rather than what I looked like. Fortunately, and some people say my book is actually a love story, a love letter to my hairdresser Andre, who actually is still my hairdresser to this day, for the many times he rescued me from another bad hair day like that day I opened the door to the world's press.
Let's talk a little bit about the work you did while you were in Downing Street and then later with women and children. I've got a number of questions here about, you know, where your focus is, what you think will have the most impact for good, and what are some of the really tragic things that you've seen that have most moved you?
Well, I think when the time came for us to leave Number 10, I realized that I had this accumulated knowledge and experience over those 10 years, because as time went by, not only did I accompany my husband, but also I would go on trips on my own. Of all the departments in the government, the Foreign Office actually were the nicest to me, really, because when we go on trips, they're always, and I think perhaps because they're used to the spouse of the ambassador tending to have a role, as I'm sure you're all aware. And so, you know, they would, I would do a lot of things with the Foreign Office, with women in the various countries we went. I'd meet lawyers. And so I thought, what am I going to do? Is that just a fantastic life experience for me? Or is it something that I can use after Number 10 to make a difference? And I decided I wanted to focus on women for the obvious reasons of the great debt I owe to the strong women in my family who made me what I am. And also because actually nowhere in the world do women have absolute equality with men. And, you know, I strongly believe until we do achieve that equality of respect and equality of opportunity, then we won't actually build the world that we need to see in the future. So I thought, well, what can I do to help other women? And because of what I'd seen in the developing world, I thought, it's not that we don't have problems in the West, for want of a better term, but what I noticed in my travels is the sort of experiences that my mother and my grandmother had, and to some extent towards, you know, when I was starting, which really we don't have so much now in relation to discrimination against women in our countries. But if you go abroad, if you go to parts of Africa or Asia, they are still experiencing exactly those things. And I thought, well, given that we've been through that, we've made our mistakes, you know, there's an opportunity there to help them accelerate the process of change without making some of the mistakes that we made. So I thought I wanted to do that, and because of my belief that one of the reasons why I have been able to do things that my mother and grandmother could only dream of is because I had financial independence. I felt that if you can help women get that financial independence. In too many parts of the world, you know, the birth of a baby girl is not regarded as a matter of joy, but is seen as she's seen as a burden. I mean, in some parts of the world, she doesn't even get born, does she? Mm-hmm. Then you get to the stage where too often in some parts of the world, the women, again, are seen as burdens on their husbands or people that have to be kept inside the house. And at the end of their life, many widows suffer huge discrimination. So all of that is to do with the fact that they're not acknowledged as contributors to their families, to their communities. And if they get economic independence, if they've been able to be seen to be economic actors, I think it makes a big difference. So I thought, right, economic independence is what we should encourage. And then I looked around and I saw that across the world there are many, many great schemes for microfinance. And I thought, well, I don't want to duplicate that. But what I'd noticed, and which I think people now acknowledge, is that the problem is that it's very difficult for women to move out of very small home-based businesses which into small and growing businesses which don't just employ themselves and maybe some family members, but actually employ other people. And we all know that actually who are the drivers of the economy? It's small and medium-sized enterprises. And women face particular obstacles in getting that. So across the world, I think 70% of the women in employment across the world are actually in the unofficial economy, aren't in the official economy, don't ever get the chance to develop their business. So we've concentrated in my foundation, the Cherie Blair Foundation for Women, in helping that group of women who have a business skill which could be grown and developed so that they do employ, whether it's 5 or 10 or even 50 or 100 other people, to help them, because I think they are the drivers not only of the economy but also of changes, social changes for women too. And what do those women need? Well, they seem to need three things. One is they need confidence building. Because so often they've been told, you know, they can't do that, or that, you know, these are not jobs for women. I mean, I know that myself, having been told that as a woman lawyer. They need capacity building, because so often, you know, girls don't get the same level of education across the world as boys. They don't get the opportunity to have the sort of business training which we try to give them, about whether it's financial planning, business development, employing other people. And the final thing that women don't get across the world is access to capital. It's often, banks are extremely reluctant to lend to women. Often they only lend on the basis of collateral, which is land. And in many places, women either don't have or actually expressly forbidden to have land, and therefore they don't have that collateral. And so it's a question of how do we devise ways of allowing women to get capital for their business so that they can grow. And that's what we try and do. And we have three little separate programs. We have some business development centers, which are mainly in the Middle East because my husband's new role. So we have business development centers, two in Palestine, one in the Lebanon. And we also have a similar scheme in northern Israel, where women can come for a one-stop shop advice about setting up businesses and development. And then we have two more global schemes, one of which is about, it's called M Women, and it's part of a much bigger program, which is about helping women use mobile phones as tools for their business. Because the mobile phone across the world is the poor person's computer. Text messaging, access to markets, access to mobile payments, all of these things can reach women in rural areas, in townships, which other kinds of things just can't reach. And then the final program we have is a mentoring platform that we've developed with Google, which in fact we're launching, we've done a pilot and we're launching in New York with the United Nations Development Program in the beginning of October. which enables men and women in our countries to actually form a relationship of a year with women entrepreneurs that we identify through our partners, whether through our business centres that we do ourselves or through the UNDP, who've identified through their scheme some women in Kenya and in Swaziland, and with other partners in India. So we and that relationship involves using Google tools and either using email or maybe a video conferencing, depending, because these are more sophisticated women who both can speak English and have access to a computer. So we have, and it's been very interesting. In the pilot, we had one example where we had one woman in Palestine who had already been working from her home with a bakery. And she wanted to expand her bakery and open a restaurant doing traditional Palestinian food. And her mentor was a man in Birmingham in England. And in the course of their years mentoring, because we have a beginning and an end, he helped her develop a business plan, identify the YMCA, who were giving grants for small businesses. She got a $5,000 grant and helped her set up and launch that business. And why I loved that story particularly was that if in fact he had been in Palestine, he couldn't have done that for her. Because as a married woman, she would not have been able to be face to face with this man. But over the internet, that happened. And of course, similarly, we have tie-ups between women as well as mentors. I mean, many of our mentors are women, but the great thing is it's something that men and women can do. And
how much of this opportunity, which is really very extraordinary, how much of it has come about because you were in Downing Street for 10 years?
Oh, absolutely. Because, Cherie Booth QC in 1997, no one would have heard of her, really, would they? But, Tony Blair's name is a global name. And it enables me to go into, to speak to people in, whether it's Kenya or Swaziland or Israel or Palestine or Lebanon. We have another scheme in the Lebanon, and be able to get to the right people, to make the links. It enables me to go out to people like Google or to some great individuals who've given us money, absolutely. And I'm so lucky to have that opportunity and to be able to use that platform, which actually, to some extent, I still have, to help other women.
You know, part of it, you mentioned that you were friends to two presidents. Could you talk, and of course this audience would be very interested in your perspectives on the Clintons and on the Bushes. How did you find them, and what kind of relationship did you have with them?
Well, obviously, let me say first of all that we had really good relationships with both of them. And then the great thing is, I just saw Hillary Clinton this morning because I was at the APEC meeting speaking there. And we still keep in touch with George and Laura too. And it's a strange thing, I suppose, in that when you become, when your husband becomes leader of a country, there is a sort of affinity with other leaders, even if you don't necessarily share the same politics, because some of the issues that you're going through, foreign policy particularly, isn't really about internal party politics. It's about trying to do what's right in the individual situations, some of the common experiences, whether it's with the press or with, problems within your own party or opposition parties, whatever it is. There's a lot that you have in common. I think the difference between our my relationship with Hillary, for example, and my relationship with Laura is really this, that in 1997, when I came into Downing Street, Hillary Clinton had already been First Lady of her country for 3 years by then, and before that had been obviously the governor's wife in Arkansas. So she was an experienced First Lady, and it is a skill. That's for sure. And so she was like a mentor to me, because we knew each other a little bit anyway. And one of the first things we did when Tony became Prime Minister, the President came over to meet us, and then we went to the G7 summit, as it was then, in Denver. And Hillary was hosting that program, and I had been told by the Foreign Office that actually next year it was in the UK and I was hosting it. So I was desperate to see how the professional did it. And she was terrifically kind to me. She gave me some really good advice, which was particularly about how do you deal with the hostility of the press, which obviously she knew something about too. And she said, you know, you've got to learn that, you know, you're not going to please everybody all of the time. And that there are, and this is true, that there are some people who, even though they don't know you, will dislike you not because of actually any of your personal qualities, but just because you represent something that they think they dislike. And therefore, you need to remain true to yourself and decide what it is you want to achieve and just try and do that and not be distracted by worrying too much about what other people say about you. That was really good advice. Now, when 2001 came along and the Bushes came along, of course, with Laura, it was slightly different because in this case, I was the one who'd been, you know, I'd done by that time four, you know, G8 meetings, and I knew the other spouses of the other people. And so there was more of a sort of equality between the two of us. I think the other difference was that by this stage, her two daughters were more of the same age as my older children. So we had a more of an equal relationship in that respect. And Laura and I went to Rwanda together, and I will always remember that trip because we went to the Holocaust Memorial Museum there, and there's this incredibly moving room in there which is about the children who were killed during that Rwanda genocide. And they invited all the parents to put up pictures of their children and describe them, and we were there, and one of Laura's daughters was there too. And you know, you cannot as a mother go into that room and not, you know, cry together, which we did, because it was just so deeply moving. So
now, one person that probably does have different politics from you would be George Bush. Yeah. So how did you relate to him?
You know, George is he's a great fun person to be with, and he was very, very tolerant of me. I mean, you know, there was he honestly was. And I can remember the first time he came to check us, and my son was a bit older, and his friends were there, and somehow or other we ended up talking about capital punishment, a topic which, as you might imagine, George and I don't really agree on. And he took it very, very, very well. Tony was kicking me under the table most of the time. it's true to say. And then there was a time we went to Crawford, and I was involved in a campaign at that time, which was about the International Criminal Court which is now in The Hague. And the campaign I was involved in was making sure that we got enough women judges on that, and which indeed we did, but it was something I cared very much about. And at that time, the America, because Bill Clinton, one of the last things he did as president was sign the treaty. And the question was whether George was going to unsign the treaty. And so I couldn't, I'm afraid, resist the opportunity to lobby him about not unsigning the treaty. And I always remember that I raised it with him at lunch, and as we left, he mentioned to Tony that I mentioned this to him. So Tony was again, Cherie, for goodness sake, you know, leave me to deal with these things. And then as we were going out, George came up behind us and said, He says, now I know why Bill Clinton signed that treaty. It's all your fault, which is not true at all. But, you know, he took it in good part. He made a joke about it. He listened very courteously to me. He didn't do what I asked him to do. Yeah. But, you know, I have to say that he was always very charming company.
Now, another famous group of people that you got to see up close and personal were the royal family. And how did you feel about them, and what was your relationship like?
Well, for me, again, to get that close to the Queen, as well, I'm not claiming that the Queen and I are intimate friends, but to see her that close was an extraordinary thing, and I'm a huge admirer of the Queen and the way, I mean, she's going to be 60 years on the throne next year. And, it's very hard for someone like me, who was born in the second year of her reign, to imagine what it would be like without the Queen. And those times in Balmoral were extraordinary times. I mentioned the barbecue. There's a tradition at Balmoral that it's actually, we're always told when you go to Balmoral that on the Saturday night, either we'll go on the barbecue, in which case, because it's Scotland and it's September, you need to bring your boots and your woolly sweaters, or you'll have the dinner inside the palace, in which case it literally is, as they say, you know, it's evening dress with tiaras. Not that I ever had a tiara to bring, but, you know, so you'd have this mad sort of packing experience where you'd have the two things nestling together. And then, of course, it was the fact that also you have the maid unpacks your belongings, which led to that interesting incident which ended up with Leo coming along. I don't think I can tell that story just now. But you know, at the end of the barbecue, which Prince Philip cooks the barbecue, the staff prepare it all, but he actually does the barbecuing. And then at the end, the Queen insists on getting up and clearing up the plates, you know, and of course your first instinct is say, oh no. But no, absolutely no way will she allow you to do that. So that's
a different insight.
It is a different insight. The other great thing that happened at Balmoral was when Leo was born, it made a big difference. And we took him for the first time. We asked, could we? And we did. And the Queen Mother was still alive. And of course, she was born in 1900. And here was Leo born in 2000. And so the Queen said, you know, would you like to have a photograph of Mummy, which is what she called the Queen Mother, holding the baby? And indeed, we did. And then the next year we went and the Queen Mother was still alive, so we have these photographs. And then when the Queen Mother died, we went to Balmoral that year, and I said to the Queen Mom, would you mind if this year Leo had his picture taken with you? And she very graciously said he could. So Leo was a very lucky boy. He has a series of photographs of me and, first the Queen Mother and then the Queen. And she was very, very sweet to him, very, very nice to this little chap.
Little boy.
Yeah.
I also had a couple of questions about what it was like on the hot seat in Downing Street during the invasion of Iraq and all of the trauma that both countries went through over that. And how did you feel about it, and what was your perspective during those years?
Well, I think the first thing I felt about it was that, Tony was absolutely doing what he believed to be the right thing, and which I believed to be the right thing, and it wasn't, you know, for me to second guess or indeed even tell him what to do. My role, very much at that point, was to support him in an incredibly difficult time, when he was committing our troops to go out, you know, and face, and some of them were, killed. Mm-hmm. And not only were our troops killed and the Allies' troops killed, but also members of the public in Iraq were killed too. And you know, this weighs very heavily. You don't take those decisions very lightly. And the most important thing for us was to support him and help him make the right decisions. So it was a difficult time. I think my children had quite a difficult time at school then, because they were then older teenagers, and other teenagers at school would have different views. And there was a time when we were living in Downing Street and you could hear all the time the protesters outside calling for you.
Yeah.
But, you know, I never had any doubt, and I still don't have any doubt, that Tony took the right decisions and that history will vindicate the stand that we took. And I think there are plenty of people in Iraq who will say, as they do, thank you for what we did.
You know, unfortunately, we've reached the point in our program where we only have time for one last question. So I have to ask you, Helen McCrory has played you twice in The Queen and The Special Relationship. What do you think about her impersonation of you?
Well, I always say when I saw that film, my instant thought was, oh, if only I was that thin. Funny enough, I haven't met Helen McCrory, but you know, there is this other film called The Ghost. Have you seen that?
No.
Now, that's the one that's got Pierce Brosnan and I actually have met the lady who plays the me character in that. And what's very interesting is I knew her mother. Her mother actually was a female barrister too, and I think she played her character very much from what she based on her mother actually more than on him. When
Small
I met
world.
Her, she she said as much to me. But I mean, that was a good one. Where I get to sleep both with Pierce Brosnan and with, you know, the, it was, who was it? Was it Ewan McGregor, I think it was, or something like that, you know? Chance would be a fine thing, girls.
So with that, our thanks to Cherie Blair, noted attorney, founder of the Cherie Blair Foundation for Women, and author of the memoir, Speaking for Myself, My Life from Liverpool to Downing Street. Thank you very much. And we also want to thank our audiences here and on the radio. And we want to remind everyone here that copies of Mrs. Blair's books are on sale in the lobby, and she will be pleased to sign copies of her book in the lobby immediately following the program. We appreciate it if you would allow her to get to the signing table as quickly as possible so we can get that going. And I am Mary Cranston. And now this meeting of the Commonwealth Club of California, where you are in the know, is adjourned. Great job. That was so fun. Thank you. You're the best.